unsee the territory of the Musqueam people, to whom we are still beholden for these wonderful amenities. I say that because this is the beginning of another series of the passions that drive academic life, otherwise known as the Senior Scholars Series. John Gilbert would be hosting on this occasion, but John, what do you know? He's been called away.
He's in Bath at the moment.
Oh, he's only in Bath.
He's on this planet.
He's just around the corner. But we can expect him back, I think, in time for the next one in this series, which I'll announce before the end of the hour. For quite other reasons than this series, I was reading a lecture given by C.S. Lewis just the other day. Lewis, after already a brilliant career in Oxford as a literary critic, in addition to all the other things that he was writing in his spare time, was appointed to a brand new chair in Cambridge, and so gave an inaugural lecture one day in November 1954 to introduce himself, I suspect, mainly to his esteemed colleagues in Cambridge, who were suspicious of him as he was suspicious of them, but was trying to talk over their heads to the students whom he hoped to capture, I suppose, as a constituency as he moved into this strange and possibly hostile zone. It's a splendid lecture, completely devoid of literary critical content, but a wonderful spectacle, really, of an Oxford professor of a certain kind at a certain date. And Lewis is only too aware of the spectacle that he's making. Indeed, as he comes to the end of the hour, and I expect he timed it to perfection, he put it to the audience of Cambridge students, if there were in fact any in the room, that while he might very well fail them in future as a critic, because after all, Cambridge was the place for criticism, whereas he was from Oxford and was really, you know, some kind of old-fashioned philologist, he might nonetheless serve them as a specimen. I would even, he says, dare to go further, speaking not only for myself, but for all other, now capital letters, old Western men whom you may meet, I would say, use your specimens while you can. There are not going to be many more dinosaurs. I mean, so the old Western bit is partly he's come from Oxford, which is in the West. Huh. Well, I stopped at that point, did a quick check to confirm that on the very day that Lewis gave that lecture, he turned 54. Of course, it's not true. It was never true that there weren't going to be any more dinosaurs. Every university, every well-endowed university, has a Jurassic Park. And all would-be literary critics, Herbert and I could agree, sooner or later graduate to become specimens. Well, you can see why this caught my eye in connection with this series. Here is Herbert, camera paused, almost as a kind of latter-day taxidermist, to ensure that the wonderful specimen seated in the professorial chair before you will go into the UBC paleontological collection. And this is something, you know, which only a very few university professors can look forward to. But that's not entirely what this series and this evening's event are about. I mean, while we clearly recognise the value of capturing such wonderful specimens, we had this idea too. That is to say, Julie had the idea several years ago that there would be a particular value for students, just as Lewis supposed there might be a value for those students in Cambridge, of having access, well, to the specimens of the dinosaurs, yes, but actually to the still lively conversation and scholarship of those 50-somethings that we all are after our 50th birthday. We stay in this profession. The challenge these days, as you can probably tell looking around the room, is to capture those specimens from the other generation who would be other side of this conversation. Because the nature of academic life now, even for those most interdisciplinary and outgoing early career scholars, is such that, you know, coming for lectures like this becomes a little harder for them to do and for us to induce them to do. But we have not quit yet. John, Judy and I and others are having continuing discussions on ways of ensuring that the opportunity that presentations of this kind presents for configuring circuits across a generation of scholarship, both for the purposes of people working in similar fields to the speaker and for the purposes of those working in other fields, that we not miss such opportunities as still exist. So we'll see what else we can do to get these conversations engaged. A long academic generation is actually not very long in relation to the history of UBC. I think it would only take three generations of long-serving professors at most to get us from 1915 to the present. If there's anybody here who thinks he or she knows or once touched fingers with a colleague who at the beginning of his or her career touched fingers with someone who was at UBC in 1915, this might be an interesting chain for Herbert to reconstruct. In the meantime, and without further ado, representing an upcoming generation of professionals working in a line of work that is highly relevant to this occasion, Elizabeth Strauss is a PhD candidate now, student, soon to be candidate in the School of Nursing. Just back from fieldwork in Oregon, something like that. She's been away. She's been teaching in Oregon. And we'll introduce our speaker. Thank you, Elizabeth.
Yes. Thank you. I'm really delighted to be able to introduce our speaker today. We were kind of thinking about who's going to introduce this talk, we thought it might be nice for the nurse, who is a pediatric nurse by background, who interestingly sort of, I guess you could say I study the long-term consequences of complex congenital anomalies, would be the one to introduce Dr. Hall today. So I'm going to keep this nice and short and sweet so that Judy can go on with her talk. So Dr. Hall is a clinical geneticist and pediatrician. She's trained at Wellesley College. She received her MD from the University of Washington School of Medicine and trained in pediatrics at Johns Hopkins Hospital. She was chair of pediatrics at UBC and BC Children's Hospital from 1990 to 2000, and she's presently professor emerita of pediatrics and medical genetics at UBC, based at Children and Women's Health Center of British Columbia in Vancouver. Her areas of research interest, as I somewhat alluded to, are human congenital anomalies, natural history of genetic disorders, and non-traditional mechanisms of genetic disease. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Judith Hall.
Thanks, Elizabeth. Elizabeth and I had a chance to talk, and she is doing really interesting things, and particularly concerned about the psychological welfare of people with children with chronic diseases and their families. And of course, in my area, that's very dear to my heart. Green and I go back a long way, like before it was formed. I had the opportunity to travel with the architects to look at other resident graduate schools, so I feel a really deep place in my heart for Green. As Mark said, these have been going on for some time, and we keep asking the residents what they'd like. So this last year, they said, we want more kind of about like life is really like, what life choices do you make, the challenges, the university, and like, how hard is it really? So I decided I would change the talk that I was supposed to give last year, and that I would try to engage those aspects of the life journey. But I also thought I should reflect what's happened in medical genetics, the challenges of an academic career, explore what's been learned about congenital anomalies over this time. And I should warn you that you're going to see lots and lots of pictures of individuals, patients that I've seen. I have their permission to show them, but they're upsetting. And if you're not used to congenital anomalies, they are distressing. But it's partly to desensitize you so that you can appreciate they're actually absolutely fascinating. And what I want to do is give you an overview and the progress that's been made. and then to share some lessons I've learned. So I've been an incredibly fortunate person in many ways. I don't think lucky is the right word because I've worked really hard, but I feel particularly fortunate to live in this wonderful country. So going back to my early years, I was a congregational minister's daughter, and he was a very liberal congregationalist, so it's a bit like be responsible for yourself. I do remember in high school, we were told not to answer the phone because he was getting threats from the John Birch Society. So he was very willing to speak out on things that he thought were important. I think probably the combination of a father who really encouraged and an older brother were really important. So this is the only family historical picture I'll show. But I credit my brother with having to keep up with him. A family that was, as you can see, a pretty good size, 5 kids. I had a very traditional mother. She was curious about biology, but she was traditional. She supported her husband and did all the things the traditional wives were supposed to do. But she did actually, I think, instill a sense of curiosity about why did those things happen. I grew up during the war years, and I remember well making soap because there wasn't any to be had. I remember coupons. It was an interesting time, and certainly for my family, who didn't have much money, it was a challenge to figure out how to do things. But we did have a summer cottage, and so in the summers we roamed the countryside and the meadows and would find insects and flowers and things that my mom absolutely loved. And we moved westward. About every 5 years we would move a bit farther. So I ended up in Seattle in high school. And it was an absolutely fascinating school, really unique in the times. It was a third Asian, a third Black, and a third Caucasian, half of whom are Jewish. So I was very much in a minority. And I also would credit that high school with, in a sense, preparing me for just accepting people as they are. Now, I think if we look at a traditional academic life, usually we think that in terms of you spend about a third of your time getting ready, about a third of your time in jobs. And I think I would point out that there's some security in academics. Today, there's very little security for young people. They have contracts, and they have to always be looking for the next step. And then, if you were lucky to survive all that, a third in retirement, and retirement was mainly for just relaxing and traveling. So I wrote a paper a few years ago on the trajectory of an academic career, and I separated it into 10-year spans with a slightly different emphasis, that the first 10 years, counting high school and college and medical school and graduate school training, the next 10 years establishing yourself, the next 10 years really engaging in your profession, the community, the institutions, the next 10 years being a mentor, taking on complex situations, administration, innovation, and then the last 10 years kind of figuring out what you want to do as you wind down. So as was said, I went to Wellesley College. I went there really because my grandmother had gone there. And of course, Hillary Clinton went there. And I mean, I think the real point was that it was a women's school. And at that time, that was an advantage because you weren't distracted by the men. And it was very rigorous in terms of needing to really study. So I was used to getting A's, and I squeaked by with B minuses at Wellesley. But I had a science teacher, because I was pre-med, that loved genetics, and I'm sure that my interest in genetics stems back to her. She used to go summers and work on genetic transferring in bacteria. So when I got to medical school, there was an elective in genetics, and so I ended up taking that and really getting very interested in genetics. I was one of 5 women in a class of 75. So you can imagine that we were unique women, but also that we got the brunt of a lot of jokes. And there was a lot of locker room talk. We were in the women hygienist locker room because they really didn't know what to do with women medical students. I did an extra year in genetics and was in the lab, and I learned very rapidly that I was a clinician. I liked patients, I liked their stories, I liked trying to help them and understand them. And I guess it's lucky that I didn't really like the lab, and so I didn't get stuck there. I was married in medical school and had my first child, and it's probably one of the best things that happened, because what it meant was that we established ourselves as a family and really worked together to make things happen. Then, as was said, I went off to Hopkins. We specifically went to Baltimore because it had the highest murder rate, the highest TB rate, the highest, I mean, it was just a hotbed of experience, and we were on every other night. So it was a very interesting thing. At that time, you had to do an internship to get a license. So I did an internship and then did a fellowship in genetics. And that was a wonderful experience, but it was during the Vietnam War. And my husband was actually drafted, spent a year in Vietnam. And I remember waking up every morning and figuring out where the fighting was going on and whether he was in danger. It was not an easy time. So then I went on to do pediatrics and endocrinology. And I must say, each of those extra years has stood me in good stead, and I'm glad I did all the extra training. And we have two more children in Baltimore, so that it was a very busy time, and I had to learn how to focus on whatever I was doing. I had a full-time live-in housekeeper. I don't think anybody should try to do those things without that, because you just can't work full time and then go home and work full time. So again, it was one of those adjustments. There were huge changes happening in genetics. When I first started, there were clinical diagnoses, and looking at the natural history, and most of the cases were pediatric. And I've always been clinically oriented. In other words, I've always wanted to be dealing with patients and figuring out what's going on with patients. Mainly I've worked in birth defects and congenital anomalies. And I particularly concentrated on short stature to begin with. Was very much engaged in Little People of America, Little People of Canada, which meant that you really understood what was happening to families. But kind of whatever came along, because whatever came into clinic meant that you needed to really try and understand them. So let me say a little bit about congenital anomalies. It means present at birth, and an anomaly basically means a structural abnormality that is present at birth. But that means you've got to think about human development. And just to refresh your memory, the embryo is when you're forming structures. So that's the first 8 weeks after conception. We call it the first trimester. And then it's fetal-like. Everything is formed, and it's got to be tried out. It's got to see if it works. So the baby begins to breathe and begins to swallow and begins to move as it's growing. And there's a period during which it can't survive on its own. And then there's a period where now, today, babies are able to survive. So the newborn should be at 40 weeks, but now, today, babies are surviving as early as 24 weeks. When I went to medical school, if you were 36 weeks, you died. That was the Kennedy baby died. So if you think about congenital structural anomalies, they're inborn errors in morphogenesis and forming, but they have a basis in biochemistry, in molecular things. So the challenge is to try and understand what's happening on a molecular level. So dysmorphic growth is always disharmonic. That means that things aren't happening when they should be happening. And of course it depends on the timing when things go wrong. So that early development is all about timing. I'm going to tell you about a family that I saw as a fellow in genetics. There were two girls with this disorder. It's called thrombocytopenia and absent radius, because these babies don't have normal amounts of platelets and they're missing the radius bone. Originally, it was thought to be another disorder where there are defects in the thumb, but this is a disorder where you have your thumbs, but you're missing the radius. And in the other disorder, you have all kinds of blood problems, but in this, just platelets, just clotting. Well, you'll see the date there, 1969. We published 40 cases that we found in the archives of Hopkins and published cases that were called the secondary disorder. About the 13th draft of that paper, I said to Dr. McKissick, is it always this hard? He said, well, actually, I think it gets harder with time. That's a message for other students. So thrombocytopenia aspirated, low stem cells that make platelets, absence of the radius, sometimes absence of the upper arm. Many other anomalies can occur, but those are the constant things. And in these families, there was a 25% chance of happening again. And that, we geneticists knew, meant that it was something called autosomal recessive, but there wasn't consanguinity inbreeding in these families. So it was, just didn't really fit the pattern. And it took 40 years to actually figure out what's going on. So in 2007, a paper was published where there was a small deletion from one parent and a mutation from the other parent. Well, this is really weird. Nobody had described that sort of thing. And when you actually look at that part that's deleted, it's a pretty big part. You can see all those symbols up above, meaning there were many genes. And yet you could be perfectly normal as the parent. So the other chromosome in that parent was making up for the missing part lost in the deletion. So this was really an unusual situation. And the implications are that you could have digenic inheritance, double heterozygotes, not matching each other, who were both alive and well with no problems, and that a carrier, a huge deletion, could be perfectly normal. So what it meant is we needed to go back and look at other families with chromosomal deletions and see what was going on. And there were all kinds of variations already known present in the genome, so we had to rethink what we call autosomal recessive inheritance. And clearly there were complex interactions we really didn't see. So moving along in terms of academic career, the second 10 years were really establishing oneself. And for me, that meant moving to Seattle. And I worked at Seattle Children's Hospital, developing clinical services, brand new specialty. And over the course of those 10 years, we actually developed it as a specialty. And we were responsible for the Washington, Alaska, Montana, Idaho district. So we did a lot of traveling. It was really interesting going up to Alaska in those days. But what I really want to say about being a clinician is that you're doing three things at once. You're trying to come to a specific diagnosis or something that's sort of like what you're seeing. You're trying to think about therapy, what can we do for this family? And you're trying to think about what went wrong, why did this happen? These are real people, they're real families, and whenever there's a genetic disorder, it affects the whole family. Everybody wonders if it's going to happen to them, or what does it mean for them? And they have all kinds of guilt and weird ideas about what happened in the family that made this happen. And so part of it is actually dealing with those families and helping every single person in the family to think about what can this actually mean for you. And of course, those questions for the family is, will this happen again? And what's going to happen to this child of ours over their lifetime? The clinic, from my perspective, is really a laboratory. Every single family that you see, you can learn something important from. And what then are the tools that we use, not in the laboratory of the usual type, but in the clinic? Well, records, you get all the previous records of that individual. You take a family history. Taking a family history can take 1 or 2 hours because you really got to go through all 3 generations. What are the ethnic differences? Anybody else have any kind of problem? And it turns out grandma, you want to talk to grandma. She's the one who knows. She knows about babies that were miscarried, all those kinds of things. And of course, what you do is a very careful physical exam, looking for unusual things, and then trying to put that in perspective. And what we found was that there weren't a good handbook of measurements. And so we developed one, everything from the length of ear to the size of your nostril. I mean, there are all kinds of human variations, and they may fit in a specific diagnosis and syndrome. And so this book ended up then, so to speak, being a classic. It's now in its fourth edition, and it's used all over the world. But the real problem is most of the measurements are on Europeans. And so we're now starting to collect measurements on other ethnic groups. So another part of what we do is take photographs. And photographs really are important in terms of documenting what's going on. So I suspect you don't have to be a geneticist to look at this little girl and say, oh, she has Down syndrome. So this was a very old photograph, and they knew there was something wrong with the child. But if you're a clinical geneticist, you look at that picture and you know exactly what it was that was wrong. So we take pictures of almost everything. And you might look at these two photographs. This is called syndactyly, where the toes are slightly fused in the upper picture and more fused in the bottom picture. But what if it was actually the shape of the toenails that was the telling thing? And so often you go back to pictures and find things you really hadn't known were there. And for most patients, we take careful pictures as well. And they're really the bread and butter of making diagnosis. And if you want to then consult with somebody, you share the pictures. They're standardized. They're now, of course, digitalized. You can quantitate them by some measurement. And you look for pattern profiles. So how do all of the different bones in a hand fit with each other? But today, videos have become really important. So there are certain behaviors that are seen in certain conditions. And the videos really help to define those. You can do 3D. And in fact, there's now a website that is used using the Israeli detection. You know, they've got it for spies and things like that. But they've used that same software. And they actually are spectacular at helping you make diagnoses. And part of our area is to know about the databases. So there are a huge number of databases that you need access to depending on what you're seeing. So curiosity. The reason I put the title as curiosity is because it's a really human trait. We're all curious. When we see something that's unusual, we end up then trying to understand what's going on. So I'm a pocket anthropologist. And when I saw this mask in the Anthropology Museum, I like made a diagnosis. Because this crest, which is called Mouvement, has a syndrome called Treacher Collins. And a third of people with Treacher Collins have cleft palates. And the story about Mouvement is he's really smart, but he's always got snot coming out of his nose. And he can't really talk. But he is so smart that he helps everybody solve problems. And he cries out, well, if you have an unimpaired cleft palate, you will end up getting recurrent ear infections. So the poor guy was having recurrent ear infections. And it seems to me there had to be a real model in the First Nations for this crest, because they've incorporated the natural history into the legend. And part of saying that is every culture is really overwhelmed when an individual is born with congenital anomalies. And most primitive cultures, most indigenous cultures, consider it something very powerful. And they often make such a person the shaman, because they think they have special powers of understanding death and disease and disaster. So we're all curious about congenital anomalies, but I just want to point out how common they are. 5% of all individuals are born with some type of congenital anomaly. If you look at them at birth, you recognize 2 to 3% of major congenital anomalies, but another 3 to 15% of more minor anomalies. But by 2 years of age, congenital heart disease, missing kidney, has been recognized. And by 5 years of age, between 7 and 10% of all children have some kind of major congenital anomaly. And it used to be a major cause of death. But as infant mortality has decreased because of being able to treat diarrhea and infectious disease, the incidence of congenital anomalies has gone up slightly. But relatively, it's now the leading cause of infant mortality. In the 70s, when I was first starting, the March of Dimes were very much into prevention. And they did an international study. and found data that suggested that 7.9 children are born a year with a birth defect across the world. So the more we understand, the more we may be able to treat or prevent. And 3.3 million children die a year with birth defects. 94% of the births are in middle and low income, and so that's where 95% of the deaths are. And again, the range is fairly consistent in terms of how frequently they're observed. So of course, if you're in this field, you want to know how to prevent. Well, some of them are due to infections, and so immunizations will prevent those, for instance, the case of rubella. Fortification is really important, and we've learned that neural tube defects can be prevented by folic acid. Thyroid problems can be prevented by iodine fortification. Huge impact in terms of prevention. Maternal nutrition, of course, is important, but also very simple therapies for the really common defects are really now available to anybody. So I want to make the distinction between the major anomaly, that is a structural abnormality present at birth, that will significantly affect the function of that individual. And a good example are neural tube defects, which are really very common around the world. 50% of them can be prevented through mom getting enough folic acid before she becomes pregnant. And I say before she becomes pregnant because the neural tube closes at 28 days, that is about 2 weeks after her first miscarriage. So if she's not taking it before, then it's not going to work. And that's the reason now that European countries, North and South America, fortify grains, put folic acid into them. And it's had a huge impact. And what we hope is, of course, that something else that dramatic can be found. But there are other kinds of anomalies that are obviously interfere with one's ability to live. But they're also what we describe as minor anomalies. That is, they have a minimal effect. An example is interning with the little finger. It's called clinodactyly, runs in families. It doesn't really interfere with your functioning. And then there are developmental variants, something like a high forehead, that may be cosmetically interesting, but don't really lead to major anomalies. So when we think about congenital anomalies, there's a lot of impact on society, on people you know, on your friends, maybe in your family. One of the really important things is the placenta. So the placenta is the communication between mom and baby. It's the most important organ you ever have. And you, well, not you really, your mother and your doctor, threw it away when you were born. Because it communicates between mom and baby. And as I'll come to later, there's a huge amount of communication that comes to you. It's grody looking. No wonder you threw it away. But there's now a great deal that's been learned about the placenta and its metabolic interactions between baby and mom. And it changes over the pregnancy. And mom's basically telling baby what it's going to be like when you get out. So if she's telling baby, I don't have enough food, it's going to be starvation when you get out. Baby's actually adjusting to that and being programmed in utero. Now, I want to point out, you don't usually think of all the stages you've already been through, although Mark made the point. There are very different physiologies at different stages of human development. And what we're learning now is that as soon as fertilization occurs, before implantation, there's already a change in the metabolism of baby. The embryo goes through all these stages of development. The early fetus is trying things out, trying to survive. The newborn shifts yet another whole set of physiologies. As you know, if your parents at 2 years of age, you stop sleeping, you stop eating, and you learn to say no. And your whole body has changed, and so it's no wonder that happens. Well, I'm sure that all of us are sort of interested in 12, 13 and 11, and like what's happening as we grow older. Now, let me tell you about something that happened when I was in Seattle that was really a real insight. And that is to try and understand the processes that lead to congenital anomalies. And what we did at that point is say, okay, there are different kinds of processes. A malformation is when things don't actually form. And a disruption is when they've formed, but they're actually disrupted. And deformation is when things are squashed. And a dysplasia is just one tissue. So we diagram that out. In other words, the top is normal development. Malformation is when things just don't form. They don't close. They aren't formed in a normal way. A disruption is when they've formed, and it's a problem at a later stage in development. Amniotic bands, that is when the membranes around the baby rupture, the little strands can pull off and wrap around the baby and actually lead to amputation. So you can see this toe's about to drop off. Those fingers have dropped off. And if baby swallows them, they can actually make clefts in them. So you can have a baby that looks very malformed, but it isn't. It's disruption. And it's secondary to what are called amniotic bands. And then there are deformations. They're squashing. So this is a baby that didn't have amniotic fluid. And so it was couldn't move. It was just all squashed. And you can see poor little limbs are all held tight. Because if you haven't moved in utero, then you're going to be stiff. And even the head was squashed down on the top of the uterus. And you see the poor little nose is squashed as well. And finally, dysplasias, when you have just one tissue involved. And these are various kinds of dwarfing that are problems with the bone and cartilage growth. And you don't have to be an expert to look at them and know they're each a different disorder. And people interested in short stature have learned about what the specific problems and anomalies are. I want to say something about twins in passing, because I love twins. I think you all know there are identical twins, that is, twins that come from one single egg, or dizygotic twins that are two separately fertilized eggs that are in the same uterus. They're really quite common. That is, one in 80 births, or one in 40 individuals is a twin. But there's a marked increase of all kinds of problems for twins. And we've learned a lot from twins. So there's an increased risk of miscarriage or abortion or prematurity. That one twin is undergrown. There are major changes in mom's physiology. She becomes more likely to be diabetic. She has less room to breathe. And there's an increase in every kind of congenital anomaly. So there are malformations where things just don't get finished off. And there are conjoined twins where they don't completely separate. And there are even twins within twins where there's a twin trying to form. Monozygotic twins share their placenta 70% of the time. And so there can be blood that shunts from one to the other. And that, of course, can lead to clots. And so you can have clots to one baby from the other baby that lead to all kinds of what we call vascular compromise. And then there's the squashola. Those two babies are in there, so one gets its head squashed and the sutures of the skull actually get fused together, or you can have all kinds of other things like clubbed feet and dislocated hips. But monozygotic twin is really very interesting, and it may be a congenital anomaly in itself. Nobody really understands why it happens. But the geneticists have always used twins comparing monozygotic with dizygotic and said, oh, that's the difference between inheritance. But if you're prone to anomalies, then it's not quite right, so there's a caution there. And there are monozygotic twins with discordance, where one has a disease and the other one doesn't. And so there are many really interesting things. Well, I want to say something about teratogens before I move along. And teratogens are environmental insults, something from the outside, not genetic, but something from the outside. They can be drugs, like fetal alcohol. And when I was in Seattle, Jones and Smith first described fetal alcohol syndrome. And before that, we had actually used alcohol to put down premature labor. I mean, you encouraged women to drink, if you can believe it. We now know a great deal about fetal alcohol spectrum and the problems involved. I was involved in describing something called warfarin embryopathy, where you have abnormalities of the bones and the nose and other things due to clotting. So warfarin, as you may know, is a blood thinning medicine, and it's pretty good and it's used a lot. But if you're a young individual with congenital heart or a heart surgery, you need to be on warfarin. It can be a problem for the pregnancies. But there are also infections that can lead to problems. This is a baby with cytomegalic inclusion infection with all kinds of abnormalities. But one of the interesting things is you're dealing with two different genomes, two different individuals. Mom's metabolism counts and baby's metabolism counts. So many of the times that you have a drug reaction, it's because both mom and baby are metabolizing that drug differently. And good examples are codeine and warfarin. So that was the time that I was in Seattle. And then 1980 was a really bad year. It turned out my husband was 40. And men at 40 are kind of saying, is this all there is to life? And he decided he liked his nurse. So I had to make some hard decisions. It turns out that because I had a husband who had a good salary, I was the lowest paid full professor in North America. By then we'd actually figured out what the going rates were, and I was the lowest paid full professor in North America. And so now I was on my own, and I had to make some hard decisions. Well, the women's group at the University of Washington wanted me to be their case 11 go court and all that, so I had enough for the year. And I decided that was not really what I wanted. So it gave them a year to increase my salary, and when they did, I started looking for jobs. And probably the most wonderful thing that happened to me was to come to Vancouver. It was with a lot of trepidation. It was right after all the Quebec uprising. I thought being an immigrant, I would be treated differently. Well, everybody in Canada is. And I was the luckiest thing to come here. And I ended up being in terms of the clinical genetics unit. And we had a wonderful group of people, and I loved it. And it was just when genetics was becoming part of public health, we were beginning to understand how much heterogeneity actually existed, and beginning to do some therapeutic trials to treat people. And we got interested in adults and all the adult diseases as well. And so this is kind of my third 10 years, where I was engaging in the profession and the community, and really beginning to be engaged in the institutions. So it was a time when we were looking at what was happening in terms of various kinds of professions. So I got very much involved in the American Society of Human Genetics, the Canadian Society of Human Genetics. I got involved in my community because of my kids. I got involved in institutions that exist. And I got interested in arthrogryposis. So I've spent the last 30 years on arthrogryposis, and so I want to tell you a little bit about it. It's multiple congenital contractures that are non-progressive. So it's babies that are born with multiple contractures. And why is it so interesting? Well, it's all about embryonic and fetal movement. And all of the causes, muscle, joint, nerve, share decreased in utero movement. So what happens when you don't move? Well, we elders know you get real creaky. Imagine you're going from a baby this big to a baby this big. You end up with really stiff joints. And why do those happen? So congenital contractures are actually fairly common. One in 500 babies has a club foot. One in 300 babies has a dislocated hips. And one in 3,000 to 5,000 have multiple contractures. So contractures are really common. One in 100 babies has them. And they come in all shapes and forms. Some are flexion, some are extension, some are twisted. Some have other problems like hernias. Some are really, really stiff. And arthrogryposis is not a diagnosis, it's a sign. And then the challenge is to figure out why it happens. It can be because of a neurologic problem, because of crowding, because of maternal illness, because of connective tissue that's weird, because of vascular compromise, because of muscle defect. They all have limited fetal movement, and that leads to multiple congenital contractures. So it's a deformation. In other words, things form, but because of not movement, you end up with other things. So we've done several studies, and they've been done all over the world, to find out how common it is. 1 in 3,000 babies here in BC. A third of them have a very specific disorder. A third have bad abnormalities of their brains that don't work. And a third are a very heterogeneous group of disorders. So how do you approach that? What are the ways to find out what you're dealing with? Well, what are the clinical discriminators? And it turns out, we found out that it's, do you mainly have limbs involved? Do you have limbs plus other body areas? Or do you primarily have a central nervous system problem that may be lethal? And when we did our first study of 350 babies coming to clinic, 50% had primarily limbs. Almost 40% had limb plus other body. And only 10% had CNS abnormalities, but that's because they died. Because at birth, it's a third, a third, a third. And when we look at the specific disorders, you're not supposed to be able to read this, you can see that there are many, many disorders. But I want to tell you about the classical arthropodosis. Orthopedists know about it because they see it. As soon as these children are born, they're sent to the orthopedist. And it's typical in having symmetric involvement. So they're the same on both sides. And very, very bad club feet. They have internal rotation of their shoulders. They all look the same, except they can have extended feet, a knees or flexed knees. They all look the same. Internal rotation of shoulder, extended elbow, flexed wrist. They have a big hemangioma in their forehead. They look the same at an older age. But what happens is the muscle has turned to fiber. And so as their bones grow, they get some flexion of their arms. And I think you can see in even an older woman, you see very markedly decreased muscle, but the same kind of positioning. And there's absence of muscle with replacement by fiber. About 10% have a vascular abnormality of some kind. And there's an increase in one of monozygotic twins. So there's 10 times the number of monozygotic, one of monozygotic twins that there should be. And we've now seen hundreds and hundreds of cases, and it never recurs. And they're really smart. They're like smarter than average. And at first I thought that was because, okay, they're kind of gimpy and that's why everybody thinks they're smart. They're really smart. They're smarter than their twin, and they're smarter than everybody else in their class. But why does this happen? Well, what we've proposed is that there's some kind of vascular compromise that gives them these other kinds of anomalies, loss of fingers, gut anomalies, that compromises the spinal cord as it's developing. Because what we know is hand movement starts at 12 weeks, and they don't have any of the creases in their hands. So they've stopped moving before 12 weeks, but they finished development at 8 weeks. So there's something happening during that period. And it's been around forever. So this is Riviera in the 1600s. It's called the club foot, but by now you'll be able to help me diagnose this. Extended elbows, internal rotation, and when you go to the Louvre and see the picture, it's got a nice hemangioma in his forehead. So how do we separate these? Well, we take this clinical approach of mainly limbs, limbs plus other body areas, or limbs plus the central nervous system. And if we look at some of the just limbs, they are really interesting because they have these clenched hands, but when they open them, they go out laterally. And they can have bad club feet, or they can have a point of varus feet. And there's a whole set of different disorders. You can't read this, but Freeman-Sheldon disorder has involvement of the muscles of the face. So all of the face is bunched up as well. And the genes have been found for many of these now. So in a particular family, you can know what exactly is going on. So you can see that an individual with Freeman-Sheldon would not be able to walk, would not be able to use their hands. would have this involved in the face. It's an autosomal dominant once it occurs. And so you can see Dad's hands are opening out laterally. And he's covered up his facial contractures with that nice beard. But again, the pocket anthropologist in me noticed that there is a First Nations crest called Zunukwa. She's the old woman of the woods. And the children are told, you better stay in the village because Zunukwa will eat you. Zunukwa can't run very fast. So if you run right back to the village where you should have been and should have stayed, you'll be okay. And if she grabs you, she can't hold on very tight. So you'll be able to get loose. And so one of the things about Zunukwa is that she's a cross between a bear and a human. And I think you can appreciate those hands look a bit like bear claws. I've talked with a number of anthropologists and some First Nations people, and they say, sure, there must have been somebody born that was observed and that then was incorporated into this legend. So again, I want to just say one more thing about arthrogryposis because it's so interesting. And it's about fetal akinesia. In other words, if you don't move, you get a whole bunch of secondary things. To movement is necessary for you to grow in a normal way. So these babies that have fetal, that is, they didn't move, akinesia, they get deformed. They have contractures, they have underdeveloped lungs. In other words, you're supposed to be breathing in utero. If you don't breathe in utero, you will end up with underdeveloped lungs. They have short umbilical cords because they haven't been swimming around. They haven't been swallowing, and so they haven't developed their gut. And they have really interesting cranial facial changes. They don't have a normal baby face. They have a small jaw that sticks back and may give them a cleft palate. They have depressed tip of their nose. They have a high bridge of the nose. In other words, even for the face to be the normal face of a baby, the baby we think of, it has to be moving. And so, both in animal experiments and humans, you can see if a baby doesn't move, a whole bunch of secondary things. In other words, lack of normal mechanical forces is really necessary not to have secondary deformations. Use is absolutely essential for normal development in utero. And there's this whole set of secondary things that occur if you're not normally moving. In other words, as organs begin to function, muscles begin to contract. They stretch the developing tissues from the inside and the outside. And when does that happen? Well, at 4 weeks, that is 2 weeks after the first missed period, the heart begins to beat. Between 5 and 6 weeks, the head and the trunk begin to stir. By 7 weeks, the shoulders are shrugging. By 8 weeks, you actually have rhythmic breathing, even though the larynx hasn't opened. The diaphragm is trying to make the lungs work. And your jaw starts to move. By 9 weeks, the upper arms are starting to move. By 10 weeks, the lower limbs are kicking. And by 12 weeks, both the hands and the feet are starting to move. On an ultrasound, you can actually see club feet easily by 16 weeks. And using ultrasound, you should be able to see that all the joints are moving. But we've done 2 studies of cases of that really severe kind of arthrogryposis, and they're not picked up. Only 25% of cases are actually diagnosed prenatally. Just horrendous. And the reason is because when you're doing prenatal diagnosis, you're measuring the head, the length of the bones, but you're not looking for movement. So only 25% of those cases does a family know what's going on and have an option about continuing the pregnancy or not. What families want to know is, will this happen again? And what's the natural history for my child? And if and only if you can make a specific diagnosis, should you actually give recurrence numbers? So we can give a 5% recurrence risk if we can't make a diagnosis. But what you really want is a specific diagnosis. So in amyoplasia, there's no recurrence risk. But other forms, there can be a high recurrence. The prognosis depends on the specific diagnosis and its natural history. So this little guy, I think you saw before, was born to a 12-year-old girl who gave him up for adoption. He didn't really like his physical therapy much, but he has an IQ of 160. He was adopted by a family where mom has arthrogryposis, and they adopted another child with arthrogryposis. And he's done extremely well because they've made the appropriate accommodations. Well, in the course of arthrogryposis, what we've done is develop a book for families for all multidisciplinary areas of work for that, of clinics that deal with them. And a very, very important group that deals with the support for the families, the arthrogryposis support group. You can see they meet, when they meet, the kids have rolling contests on the floor to see who can roll the best instead of the usual races. But I again want to leave you with the idea that there are many, many different causes, but each one of these will have a specific pathway of development, development of the myelin or development of the nerves. And these pathways are really important because if we can understand the pathway, then you can actually think about therapy. So a couple years ago, we put together the 330 genes that fall into 27 pathways that lead to arthrogryposis. And I want to give you an example of the possible therapeutic approach. This is a little girl with what's called Escobar syndrome. And it's one of the pterygium syndromes, that is where you have webs on the joints that didn't move. It has a terrible prognosis. People die in their late teens or their 20s. But it turns out that most cases are a deficiency of one of the embryonic components of the neuroreceptor. So the nerve's coming down, and it's sending a message across to the muscle or to another nerve. And there are embryonic there are embryonic proteins as part of that. But in and around the time of birth, those would shift over to being adult. The adult components are perfectly normal. The mutations are in the embryonic ones. So if you could wake up the adult ones, you can go back to being normal. And it turns out that the drug is already available. It's the drug that is used for myasthenia gravis. And so now individuals with Escobar are actually increasing their movement, getting over their small lungs, and are doing well. So if you know the mechanism, then you may be able to treat. That's the real point. Well, I'm running out of time, and I want to say something about that fourth decade. What happened was I was here in Vancouver, and the chair of pediatrics tragically was killed. And so the department was really in a very difficult state. And I was asked by the dean to consider being the chair. Well, I never thought of being a chair. But I thought, okay, that's interesting. Yeah, okay. And I was smart enough to ask for resources. I asked for a research associate to work for me, and I asked for a bunch of resources, which I was given, but actually they disappeared before I could use them. But the real point I want to make is that when you become an administrator, there are a bunch of other things that you get involved in. Professional groups, both for me in pediatrics and genetics, international committees of all, institutional committees of all kinds. When I went on a sabbatical one year, I had 57 committees to resign from. So I just distributed them among all my colleagues. You end up in local community work, your strata, your community center. For me, the Vancouver Foundation, the Vancouver Institute, and you end up working in all kinds of other international work. And one of the pleasures and privileges of being in academics is you get to go all over the world, and you have friends and associates all over the world. One of the things that I did when I was a chair was to be the president of the American Pediatric Society. And I couldn't figure out what the society did. It was very honorific. It was a really big deal to get to be a part of it. So when I was president, I did a survey of the members, who were mostly retired by then, and found out about what they did in their retirement. And a third of them retired to their community and their family and were as happy as members. A third kept doing the same things. And a third used their experience in other ways. what you should do about country, being a consultant, being a the head of their profession. So then we set up workshops in the meetings to help people prepare for those next phases. The other thing that I did during that time, because I had the research associate, was to publish a book that's now in its third edition. Well, I'm running out of time and not going to really talk about what happened in genomics, but it's incredibly exciting. Carolyn has asked me to talk at the Association Professors Group about genomics and epigenomics. I think I won't try and go on because I'm running out of time. But what I do want to say is my adventures in developmental problems has been an absolute joy. And I think what's happened over the time, you can get a feel that you begin to be able to look at it as on a genetic pathway level. And what I'm really looking forward to is what controls those genes, what turns them on and off. How does that part work? Because that's what epigenetics is all about. So thank you.
So as a psychologist, I find myself wondering about behavioral adjustment. You've commented on the intellectual, remarkable intellectual capabilities of some children, osteopetrosis. Are there interdisciplinary collaborations in the field such that people with the kinds of interests I've described are working with the...
What a wonderful question. You'd think I planted it. So the answer is absolutely yes. When I was in Seattle, we had an interdisciplinary clinic, and then at the Children's Hospital here, we developed it. But some wonderful things have happened. One of the patients I had when I first came here ended up becoming a physical therapist herself. She's the world's expert on wheelchairs, and she's done a study of the natural history of arthritis. And what she's shown is it's very different from spinal cord injuries or from spina bifida, that almost 75% are professionals that have gone on to higher education. Now granted, this is a web survey from 28 countries. The average age of people answering is about 45. But it is really dramatic how well they can do. And we're interested in what makes that happen. Is it because there's something different about how they function? So we're going to do, we're applying for a grant to do functional MRI to see what's happened. I have this theory that when the neurons are developing and they go down to hook up with the spinal cord and it doesn't respond, they say, okay, well, I'm going to look for something else to do. And they migrate or hook up with the anterior part of the brain. But we'll find out. So the other thing that's happened across Canada is that the Shriners Group have set up a collaboration. Shriners Group in Montreal has been particularly active in this and making a registry of children so that we can learn more about which therapies work and which don't. We are doing massive reviews of previous literature to figure out which therapies work and which don't. The people running the program in Shriners are occupational therapists, so they're interested in what kinds of aids can actually help. Speech therapists, so whether or not there are any problems with speech. But it's been a wonderful interdisciplinary kind of response. But maybe, Ken, being a psychologist, one of your questions has to do with what's it like to have everybody stare at you? And it's not easy. But part of it is to start talking about that early. So whenever I see a family, I talk about that they've got to talk about this child as being special. Special is, my children tell me special is a very mixed word. But to talk about it as having some unusualness, but they're okay. When I was working with short statured people, they got teased about being short. I'd say, well, the comeback is at least I don't have a big mouth. But I think helping them find the words to respond and knowing that they will be teased, but feeling okay about it. But then in those families, you also have to talk to the average children, because sometimes they may get neglected in favor of the child who takes more resources. And you have to revisit it regularly. And so what I tend to say to families is once a year, maybe it's on birthday, maybe it's the first of the year, maybe it's as you start back to school, review the situation. Who in the family needs a little extra attention? Who's having trouble? Has this child found friends that will help protect him at school? And it's just amazing. I mean, it really, they form a network, and their friends who are not disabled are incredibly protective and inclusive. But I don't think it just happens. It would be the unusual family who, without talking to other families or being part of a resource group. So I always encourage them to go to this national meeting, save their pennies and go, because they will, first of all, know they're not the worst off, and second of all, find older people who can give them ideas about what to do. Perhaps the most important thing is not to spoil that child. They've got to learn to be responsible for themselves. Yes?
Traditionally, I suppose many of these children used to die very young.
So many of the ones with arthrogryposis still do die, yeah. They just don't have the lungs or the central nervous system motivation to be able to survive. And so among that group with central nervous system abnormalities, at least half of them die at birth. But what you'd like to do is still make a diagnosis so the family can utilize that in the next pregnancy if they want to. We're interested in whether you can increase movement. So for instance, we know there's certain things that mom does that baby increases its movement. If mom exercises, the baby exercises. If mom brings coffee, the baby wakes up and moves. If mom deep breathes, the baby moves. And so in many families where they've had one affected child, we give that advice. We haven't actually been able to set up a study to look at that. But I think your question is really related to all kinds of congenital anomalies. So in the past, when a child was born, the best intentions of the family physician or the obstetrician or the pediatrician was just let them die. And I think part of that has to do with understanding what will be the natural outcome of that disorder. The beauty of prenatal diagnosis is you can actually predict what will be the natural outcome of that disorder. We're still learning.
You can do what?
You can predict in certain disorders. For instance, in Down syndrome, in extra chromosome 18, we know the natural history of what will happen. The Down syndrome organization is extremely active, and they're very protective. They feel that individuals with Down syndrome can do very well, thank you. And it's true that many really can live in a sheltered home, have a job, do many things. Relatively speaking, in the area of intellectual disability, Down syndrome's not that bad. And there are many that are much more severe. So what you'd really like is to be able to offer the family early in the pregnancy some information about, is there something you can do? Many of the biochemical disorders you can treat now. I mean, it's actually quite wonderful. So huge advances have been made. We live in a country where it's the family's decision what to do. And they get to decide they want everything done or not. And I would feel very badly if it weren't that way. We'll see what happens over time. The more we learn, the problem is that many of the treatments are extremely expensive. And still not worked out yet. So we're in a time of change. It's an interesting time, that's for sure. Yes?
You had one slide where 95%, was it infant mortality or was it the presence of different development? 95% from lower economic states.
So I think this is in developing countries. 95% of children with congenital defects die. I mean, it's actually pretty horrendous. And that's because the family just can't support them. And the healthcare system doesn't support them. So I think that that was the March of Dimes study on what was happening internationally. And certainly that was the case. It's less now, so as healthcare systems improve and resources improve. For instance, in Africa, if you have club feet, they treat them just by casting them. It used to be that you would operate, and now what we found is just by casting them, using repeated moving casts, you actually can treat them without any surgery at all. And nurses are trained to do that. There are groups of facial surgeons that go around the world treating cleft lip and cleft palate. So there are lots of treatments that have become available. For the rarer disorders, it's still a challenge to know exactly what to expect to happen. Yes?
You stress very much this, actually, the movement of the fetus. And I'm surprised, especially when with thalidomide, it was related so quickly and decisively that it was the ingestion of the drug thalidomide.
So that thalidomide is an interesting story, and I don't want to be horrible to drug companies, but they make a product because they want to sell it. If it doesn't work for this, then it's used for that. And the right kind of, so thalidomide is interesting because in experimental animals, it may not cause a problem. And humans are unique in it causing a problem. Not everybody that took thalidomide had a baby with a problem. So there are genetic differences in us in how we respond to drugs. And you may know it was actually a geneticist in Germany who said that we didn't used to see this. You know, I didn't see these kinds of defects in my clinic. There's something going on. In Canada, the drug was allowed, so we have thalidomide patients in Canada. In the US, there was a Canadian at the Food and Drug who said, I'm worried, I'm just gonna hold off. So the abnormalities were discovered before the drug was allowed in the US. There were, however, samples. And some obstetricians gave their patients samples. You know, the drug company wanted to sell it, so they gave away samples even though it wasn't available. And there are some cases of thalidomide in the US that are now suing way back, you know, 60 years ago.
In England, it was prescribed readily. I was one of the people to whom it was prescribed and chose not to take it.
Right. So I think, I mean, Mother Nature didn't expect people to be taking drugs. And then it depends on metabolism of mom and baby and how they interact, whether the drug will be cleared out or have any bad effects. And so I think in this day and age, most moms want to try and avoid taking drugs if they can. But there are many conditions where they have to take drugs. Mm-hmm. So it's not always a choice. If you have to take a drug for mom to stay alive and do well, then sometimes baby has to be exposed. I think we're much more aware. Thalidomide and rubella were really important because up until that time, the idea that something mom was exposed to could cause a problem really hadn't sunk in with the general public. I mean, alcohol, seriously, when I went to medical school, it was to settle mom down, she was supposed to have a drink. Well, yes?
Thank you so much for giving us an overview of some of the inborn errors in metabolism and hormone malformations that you've dealt with throughout your career. I guess one thing I was sort of struck with was you gave us a fairly wide array of disorders and then an even wider array of causes of those disorders. And you have a system where you're having greatly increased complexity as you delve down into it. Not terribly suspecting when you're doing
pathology. Well, that's
the fun thing. I guess moving on towards treatment, though, it becomes a little tricky for instance, for funding pharmaceutical companies. And I just was wondering whether you could comment on the interplay between academic research and funding pharmaceutical research, as well as providing incentives for pharmaceutical research in the areas that are maybe going to be able to treat 500 people, maybe 1,000 people, but they're definitely not going to be the next beta blocker drug.
So I think the right answer is drug companies are there to make money. But there are some side groups that are interested in treating rare disorders. And they are given some economic breaks. They're often particularly driven by a family where there's somebody that has money that supports the research. But one of the really scary things is there was an article in the New England Journal last spring that showed that people from these pharmaceutical companies are on the boards of the parent support groups. 75% of the parent support groups have people from pharmaceutical companies on their boards. Now, I don't think that's by chance. I think the drug companies want to make money. And how, in a sense, to protect them? Well, by good blinded studies, by good research. That's the only way we're actually going to know whether something works or not. And I think you know there are journals that will publish anything, and their journals are very, very careful about what could there be conflict of interest here and what's going on in the clinical study. So there's clinical research and there's clinical research. My research is really looking at patients and trying to describe them. Clinical research is often thought of as trying treatments. And it has to go through a lot of hoops and a lot of informing the families about what's going on. Most families, in my experience, want to help in any way they can. And if they think being part of the study could help and not cause a problem, they're willing to do so, whether it will benefit their child or not. Just like they're willing to have their information published because they want people to learn. So most families want advances in science and become experts on the conditions. I mean, in this day and age, anybody can go to the internet, find out as much as they can find out. But I think part of our job is to help to try to protect them from being part of studies where there may be some risk to them. Whenever you're using a drug, there may be a risk because we all have different reactions to drugs. Another one of my interesting experiences is having had some surgery last year and having had a reaction to heparin. So last year at this time, I was in the hospital and I had platelets unmeasurable. And I actually had to be put in a coma so I didn't hurt myself. And it's a kind of reaction to heparin that 1% of the population is at risk for. Well, heparin's a good drug, but they don't tell you you're at risk for that kind of horrible reaction. So as a geneticist, I'm really aware of individual differences. Probably killed my father and my brother. And when I was going for the surgery, I did all kinds of testing to see if it could possibly have any kind of reaction, arrhythmia, anything. And I never heard of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. So I'm really aware there could be untoward reactions. And then when you think about mom potentially causing a problem for a kid, I mean, moms always feel guilty. So I can tell you right now, whenever you see a family, you do as much as you can to share blame with this genetic for both families to be involved. I mean, it's moms always feel like they did something wrong. I don't know if that answers your question.
Mm-hmm.